Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammadin Habibi Rabbil Alameen. Wa ala alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin wa ashabihi al-ghurr al-mayameen. Wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin. Thumma amma ba'd. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon our Master Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, upon His blessed family, His loyal companions, and all of those who followed after with excellence up until the day of standing. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Thereafter, alhamdulillah, the month, the blessed month of Rabiul Awwal, the month in which the blessed messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Muhammad was born, has come upon us once again. This is a very significant time, a very important time, for the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam brought about great things for the entire world, for mankind, for humanity, and for all of Allah's creation at large. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described or addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran al-Kareem, and he said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we did not send you but as a mercy for the world. And it's this mercy that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carried within his noble heart sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and distributed. And by this mercy he encompassed people and he embraced people and he understood people above and greater than anybody else could understand them, and he accommodated people in the best of ways with his mercy, directing them back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their creator, making the path of this life clear for them. Alhamdulillah, and it's that light of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his guidance and his goodness and his mercy that we want to take from in this blessed month of Rabiul Awwal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he took people out of darknesses and into light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran al-Kareem, and he says, Allahu waliyul ladhina amanu. Allah is the friend of those who believe. يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. He takes them out of darknesses and into light. And one of the ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took mankind out of darknesses and into light was through the prophets and messengers that he sent. And we have the honor of being from the nation and the ummah and the people of the final and seal and last of all of the prophets and messengers sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. So we, in these 12 days of Rabiul Awwal, we want to dwell upon some very important issues that concern each and every one of us, concern our communities, concern the times that we live in, and are very important that we dwell upon them. They are very relevant social issues that our community is facing, and we need to address them head on and find solutions for them from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his blessed life and from the mercy that he distributed. For we have solutions for everything. Every difficulty and hardship that any man could ever face upon the face of the earth, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought solutions for it. And we need to dwell upon his blessed life and into his light to deduce and bring about those solutions for our communities and for our people. And inshallah, I hope everybody's gonna stay tuned in for the next 12 days whilst we dwell upon these issues and try to find their solutions from the Quran and Sunnah and the way of the early Muslims and the predecessors we take this great legacy of Islam from. One of the great issues that we have in our communities is forced marriage. And it's something that is not spoken about too often, but it's become very important that we come out head on and approach this particular matter of forced marriage. People of scholarship and learned people and the elderly of our communities and the wise from amongst them need to really address these issues so that the young and the upcoming generations of Muslims can understand them correctly from the perspective of Islam and not from a cultural perspective or a race perspective or a caste perspective, because all of those issues are now pushing away our young generations from Islam. And we have to remind ourselves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something very important in the Quran al-Kareem. Allah azza wa jal, he said, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Allah azza wa jal, he said, and help each other, وَتَعَاوَنُوا, and help each other, عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, upon goodness and upon piety. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ, and don't help each other upon sin, disobedience and transgression, عُدْوَان. This is a very important verse of the Quran al-Kareem that we need to understand, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be people who help each other, not people who not people who turn each other away from the religion of Islam and cause bitterness and cause enmity within ourselves and within our families. And one of the issues that's really causing great conflict within families, within communities, is forced marriage. Now, what's forced marriage? We have many scenarios of forced marriage. You know, I have cases day in and day out of young men and young women who come and say that my parents are forcing me into this marriage. My parents want me to marry a particular individual because he's from the same caste as us. My parents want me to marry a particular person because he's of, for example, he comes from our village, or we owe it to them, right? We've got a debt to pay off, and that debt will be paid off through you. And this is really crazy stuff that's happening out there. Look what Allah says. He says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Assist each other upon piety and goodness, not upon sin and transgression. Now, these young people are cornered. They feel stuck. They feel, okay, there's nowhere for us to go. What can we do, right? Some of them have the courage to come and ask questions and look for those solutions. Others think, you know what, you just carry on. I'm not going to marry that person because of a caste issue. That person's not compatible with me. I'm not going to marry that person because he comes from the same village that my parents hail from. I'm not going to do that. And if that means I'm going to leave home, I'll do that. If that means I'm going to leave Islam, I'll do that. People, do you see how serious this issue is becoming? That our young ones are ready to leave home. The home that they were born into, the home that they grew up in, the home that you saw them with smiles and joy, you're forcing them now to leave out of those homes in such bitterness just because they're not marrying somebody from the same caste, they're not marrying somebody from the same village, they're not marrying somebody from the same locality. You're worried about what people will say. Where's your worry about your children? These children that you spent so many years of your life pleasing, working for, sweating for, what's happened now? Why have you just suddenly switched? Do you know, I had a case of a young person who was a very intelligent professional, studied at university, graduated, had the best of jobs. You know, for 9 years, for 9 years, that person was in a difficult situation that his parents would not let him marry a person who he felt was very compatible with him, who he felt was pious, righteous, learned. And he felt that this person had all of the compatibility, and each of them felt, okay, we are compatible for each other. But the parents blocked it. And you know what? Shall I tell you something that you're going to say, okay, this is probably about parents who came from their homelands, Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, somewhere around the Arab world, and you know, there were villagers, they weren't professionals or anything. Do you know, in this particular case, it was unbelievable. Both of the parents were professional, and guess what, on both sides. The boy's parents were highly professionals, and the girl's parents were highly professionals. But what happened? Neither of the families wanted or were allowing for these two to get married. And what were they saying? It's going to be our bestie. What on earth are you speaking about? Allah said, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Assist each other upon piety and righteousness. Do you know, marriage is a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's a sunnah of all of the prophets and messengers who went before him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And marriage is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged young people to do and to engage in. Why? Because it's the new need of mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran al-Kareem that he made the spouse so that they could so that each of the spouses could live with each other with comfort, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and it's from his signs, wa min ayatihi, from the signs of Allah, that you know, when two people get married, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah places mawadda and rahma between them. What's mawadda? Love. What's rahma? Mercy. Right? And you'd think, why is that from the signs of Allah? Why it's from the signs of Allah? Because look, people are different. You are different to your siblings, and you grew up in the same house. You might be a twin with somebody and you're different to them, right? But then suddenly you marry somebody And you've become so compatible with them. You've connected with them. That's not the doing of man. That's from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, marriage is very, very important. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاعَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ. Any one of you who's able to get married, you should get married. You should get married. Otherwise, you should be fasting. Why? Because the fire of ego is going to be flaming, and it's, you know, it's going to be flaming, and it's going to be wanting to release its desire, and it should be done in the halal way. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged people to marry, and he set an example through his own blessed marriages sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he set an example through the marriages that he conducted amongst his companions radiyallahu anhum. And now parents are stopping their children from getting married to particular people because they feel this is going to be bestie for us. They feel this is going to tarnish our reputation. This is going to tarnish the reputation of our caste, our family, X, Y, and Z. People wake up to the reality. Allah said, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Assist each other upon piety and righteousness. You're going to say, okay. And you know what Allah says next? وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِسْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. And don't assist each other upon sin and transgression. What's happening in this case is, because parents are not allowing for these young people to get married to people whom they feel compatible with, what's happening is they're going out and committing zina, committing adultery, committing haram. And who's assisting them upon that? Their parents. Yes, their parents are assisting them upon that. Why? Because they're not allowing them to conduct this marriage in the halal way. And you know, in some cases, it's so terrible. In some cases, parents don't even care. They say, let them carry on in haram until they agree to marrying whoever we want, and we'll do that in halal. Don't you fear that on the day of judgment you will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and your children will stand against you? They will say, oh Allah, if I ended up in haram, my parents are to blame. Oh Allah, if I left the comfort of my home, my parents are to blame. Oh Allah, if I left Islam, then my parents are to blame. Why? Because over an issue of marriage, they forced me out of Islam. And they weren't bothered. They didn't care whether I stayed Muslim or not. What they cared about was, what is my family, what are our uncles and aunts going to say, what are our elders going to say, what's the family and caste going to say? Oh, people of Islam, wake up to realities. And the reality is that young people, when they are ready to marry, they should be married off, but to people who they feel are compatible with them. A young lady came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Messenger of Allah, my father's got me married off, but I'm not happy with that marriage. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam annulled the marriage. He cancelled it. This was the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another young lady came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Messenger of Allah, my father's got me married off. I'm not happy with it because that guy, I don't feel that I'm compatible with him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you're not pleased with it, we'll annul the marriage. For no man has the right, and no father has the right to force his child into marriage. You know what the lady said? She said, Messenger of Allah, I'll go ahead with it. The Prophet said, why did you ask for them? And the lady said, Messenger of Allah, the reason I asked was so that no man from this day onward ever feels that I have the authority to get my daughter married off, my son married off, without their consent. And that was stamped, not by me, not by your caste leader, not by the head of your qawm, not by the local people. This was stamped by the Messenger of Allah, Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what we have to realize is, we are followers of this great religion of Islam. And then, sometimes we see that people want to marry people from other nationalities, other races. They're stopped also. Or what are people going to say? His skin color, her skin color is different. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had black African companions like Sayyidina Bilal ibn Rabah radiyallahu an. Who wouldn't want to marry Sayyidina Bilal radiyallahu an? He had Persian companions who were not Arabs like Salman al-Farisi radiyallahu an. He had Roman companions who were not Arabs like Suhaib al-Rumi radiyallahu an.
And the Messenger of Allah embraced all of them. The Messenger of Allah instructed his companions to open up their doors and open up their homes to these foreign companions who had come and accepted Islam. How do you think Islam reached the corners of the earth? You know, we think my qawm is so high, I'm not going to allow my son, my daughter to marry into any other qawm because we're just the elite, we're, you know, nobody's above us. What are you talking about? You know, the highest qawm and the highest lineage and the greatest family to touch upon this the face of the earth is the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Sayyids, there's nobody greater than them. And don't you see that wherever you go upon this earth, you'll find Sayyids in every country of the world, in every color of the world, in every nation of the world, all of them married out into different families, into different countries, into different people. And they were Sayyids. They didn't say, you know what, we're not compatible with these people. We're from the Quraysh. We're from the blood and flesh of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who can match us? We're going to only marry within our own families. But had they not married out of their blessed family, how would have Islam reached the corners of the earth? How would have the Sayyid family reached the corners of the earth? So don't ever think that that's it, it's my caste and nothing's higher. Where's your humbleness gone? Look at the humbleness of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Humble yourselves before Allah. Your caste systems will finish when you drop down in your grave. You don't want your children to stand up against you and say, this is my father who forced me into a marriage. You know, we had a case of a woman who was forced into marriage by her father and her husband. It was a forced marriage. I mean, just look at that word. It's so abhorrent. It's so disgusting. Forced marriage. How can you force somebody into one of the most beautiful things upon the earth? Marriage is a time of joy. Marriage is a time of happiness. Marriage is bliss and felicity. What do we have? Forced marriage. Right? What will the outcome of that be? Listen to this case. One woman said to me, she said, my father married me off, forced me into marrying this person, right? Because he was from our qawm, he was from our caste, he was my father's nephew or whatever. The man beat me so badly that I ended up paralyzed. I couldn't move. I was paralyzed. This is how he treated me. You can't force love into somebody's heart. Love is a secret that comes from the heavens into the hearts of people who are attracted to each other. You know, a young man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Messenger of Allah, I'm going to get married. And the Prophet was well happy and pleased for him. But you know what the Prophet said to him? Have you seen her? Have you seen her? You know, a question like that is out of the question in our families and in our communities. No, it's like, it's really crazy. People won't even say, have you seen? I know of people who've been married off and they've never ever seen the person that they're going to marry. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, have you seen her? And he said, no, Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, انظر إليها. Go and have a look at her. Why? Because when you look at her and she will look at you, it will be a greater form of attraction towards each other and it will be easier for you to bond. Look at the understanding of the Prophet ﷺ. Look at the affection and love and understanding of the Prophet ﷺ of this great institute of marriage. Marriage is just not, okay, get married. And you know, we have cases where young people want to just give up. And it's not only young people who are not practicing Islam. You know, sometimes people listening might think, you know what, he's speaking about young people who don't practice Islam and, you know, they don't want to listen to their parents and X, Y, and Z. Look, it's not an issue of listening to your parents or not. You know, this is a line that's dropped often. Parents say, you're not listening to your mom and dad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to listen to your mom and dad. You have to do as we said. Yeah, that's fine. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed us in the Quran to respect and honor our parents. But you know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also said, "Man lam yuqir kabirana wa yarham saghirana falaysa minna." Those who do not honor their elderly and have mercy upon their young ones. What type of mercy is this? That your child Your son, your daughter is saying, I don't want to marry this person. This person is not compatible for me. I'm not attracted to this person. You say, no, you have to do that. What type of mercy is that? How are you supposed to force a food down somebody's throat when their taste buds don't like that food? You know, I travel a lot, and you know, when I go around, I can't really, I can't adapt to different foods. So I end up saying to people, you know what, just give me some rice and give me some bread and that's enough for me, right? Because you can't force your taste buds to kind of change and adopt. Likewise with marriage, you can't force it upon somebody. Love, you can't force it down somebody's throat, because then it's just going to stay down their throat and it's not going to get to the heart. Love is an attachment. Love is a connection. Love is a bond that the Prophet ﷺ understood. And he taught it in a beautiful way. So I was saying, people out there, I don't want you to be thinking, oh, he's just speaking about those people, those young people who don't want to listen to their parents. They do listen to their parents. They want to listen to their parents. But when is it that their parents will listen to them? When is it that their parents will sit down and listen to their concerns and say, son, daughter, speak to me. What do you have to say about this matter? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to sit with his companions and he used to listen to what they had to say, and he used to understand where they're coming from. You know, people came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in real difficulties, and they were in gridlock, they were in stuck situations. The Prophet would listen to what they had to say and then find solutions, give them options, this or that, and try to find the best way out for those people. But there's nobody who wants to listen to these young people. All they say is, stamp, you have to listen to your parents. End of story. No, 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 it's not like that. You have to listen to your parents, but your parents have to have mercy upon you. They have to be understanding. They have to be accommodating of what's actually happening. So don't just think this is about young people who don't practice their religion. Just a couple of weeks ago, I spoke about this on Jum'ah too. I had a case of a young lady who's a practicing young woman. And she studied the religion of Islam very well. She said, I'm leaving home. I've had enough. I said, why? What's up? They want me to marry a particular person, my cousin from Pakistan, from that village. I don't know him. I don't want to go back to Pakistan to get married from there, because I've grown up here. I want to just stay here. I don't want to go there. And so on and so forth. But they're not respecting her feelings. Listening to parents is one thing, but parents not respecting the feelings of their children is also a crime. And it's a crime that people will be accountable for on the Day of Judgment. Because everybody has sentiments, everybody has feelings. And if we don't understand the feelings of these young people, you know, if you're not worried about what happens in this world, and you know, you're ready to allow your children to leave home. And you know, some parents, this was a case of a young lady who was, she was a religious woman. Now, what's happening in that case is that this religious woman, they want her to marry somebody who's not so religious. Somebody who doesn't have an in-depth understanding of the religion and a study of the religion. She's feeling, you know what, I don't want to marry somebody who's not compatible with me. And this is a major problem that occurs. I went to visit a friend of mine in his house one day. And he said to me, I sat with him and we ate, and then his mother, elderly lady, she was going blind, losing her sight. She came in and she said to me, one of the problems that we have in our communities is, you'll have like a young lad who's memorized the Quran. This is the example that she gave. A young lad who's memorized the Quran, and the parents will force him to marry somebody who's not so religious, who's not compatible with him, just because of caste, just because of family. And she said to me, then that ends up ruining the life of that young man who memorized the Quran. And vice versa, you'll have righteous young women, religious, pious, chaste, and they are thrown in with men who are evil. They don't have any religion in them, no character in them. Why? Because that's your cousin. You have to marry your cousin. Who said you have to marry your cousin? Who said that? Why are we forcing people into all of this disaster? Forced marriage is an absolute and utter disaster. And we have to wake up to this reality now, before things get too late. And they are getting late, because I know of cases where young men and young women are not only giving up on their culture, they're giving up upon their religion. Oh people, we will become accountable before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if our young ones run away from Islam. Right? And I want to address the young ones also and say, look, if your parents are forcing you into marriage, you don't have to get married. What I would advise you is go and find an imam who understands. Find somebody pious, righteous in your community. Find an elderly uncle or aunt. Sit down with them and find a third party. Because sometimes speaking to parents ends up like, you know what, please mind my language, it ends up like speaking to the brick wall. Seriously. And what I always say to people is, try to find an uncle or aunt who your parents respect, or a local imam who understands the situation. Try to speak to them for them to mediate for you with your parents. Don't just run away from home. Don't give up on Islam because of people not understanding what the religion of Islam is. Right? Don't give up upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Have hope in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he took people out of darknesses and into light. Now, one of the darknesses that he took people out of was from the darknesses of forcing children, men and women, into marriage. He took them out of that and into the light of getting married to somebody who you feel you're compatible with, somebody you're attracted to, somebody who you know that once that contract of nikah is made, that you have a very deep feeling in your heart that Allah is going to place love between your hearts. Allah is going to create mercy within yourselves. So what I say to young people is, don't take your parents as an excuse for running away from home. Try to find mediation. Try to find help. And don't make your parents an excuse for you giving up on Islam. You know why? Because one day we'll all die. And you'll go into your grave and your parents will go into their graves. And on the day of judgment, they'll be running their own way and you'll be running your own way. People will be standing against each other. And on that day, it's every man for themselves. Nobody will stand up for anybody. So you have to save your honor for that day, that you don't die without Islam. That you stand up on the day of judgment, you say, Alhamdulillah, I've come with Islam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's very important. And my message to parents is, dear parents, we need to really break out of this arrogance and become humble. Right? Become humble before not your children, not before me or anybody else. Become humble before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If our children don't want to get married to a particular person, say to them, fine. If you don't feel compatible, let's move on, find somebody else for you. I'm not going to force you into this. I'm not going to create a bitter relationship between me and my child just for a third person, just for a family member, just for bringing somebody over and getting them a British passport. We shouldn't be doing that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Assist each other upon piety and righteousness. Don't assist each other upon sin and transgression. So we need to become from the first and not from the second. From those who help our children find compatible marriages and put them into marriage so that they can live with harmony and love and mercy with their spouses and create a beautiful house based upon this religion of Islam. And not that they run away from home, end up in zina, end up in adultery, end up in this sin and that sin. And who's to blame? The parents who threw them out of the house. The parents who wanted to force them into marriage. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for rectification. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove these darknesses from our communities and bring into our lives and our communities the light that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought to us in the form of the Quran and in the form of his blessed way. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.